Hi there, I'm Lisa Taylor, and welcome to Choose to Be You. If you are a member of our community, you know very well that I am a firm believer in the fact that we need to courageously choose to be who God made us to be. We need to courageously step into that authentic place of our true being. So many people in the world are struggling with being happy, feeling fulfilled, finding life purpose. And science shows that it comes down to, do you really know who you are? Do you really know what you want? Well, over my life, I have struggled mightily with these questions, as we all do. And I've come up with three simple steps to get to this level of clarity. Getting clear about who you are and what you want, being consistent in a daily practice that helps you get to that clarity, and then courageously going out and contributing your true authentic self to the world, because that's what's needed. The world has need of you being you. Well, recently I did a 5-hour live event and I invited 9 global thought leaders to the table to talk about this very subject, choose to be you, and courageously choosing to be who God made us to be. So I welcome you to listen to these interviews. I'm bringing them to you one by one. So let's now begin with the next introduction.
Amazing guy. So people often refer to our next guest as a Renaissance man. He's, okay, get this. He's a dentist. He's also a comedy writer, a performer, a director, an author, a producer, a radio personality, a former professor, but he's also a practitioner of spiritual healing and energy work, and has been on the board of the Association for Spiritual and Psychotherapy since Spirituality and Psychotherapy since 1999, before it was kind of vogue, right? With a long-standing career in comedy, he's the host of Comedy Matters TV, where he interviews A-list comedians. And he's the author of 7 books, including the 2 most recent, Healing Your Heart by Changing Your Mind, A Spiritual and Humorous Approach to Achieving Happiness, and Fight the Fear, Overcoming Obstacles That Stand in Your Way. Dr. Jeffrey Gurian, thank you so much for joining us. I'm so glad you're here. Hi.
Thank you so much, Lee. I am so happy to be here with you. And what a great assortment of speakers you've had so far. I've been on since the beginning.
Oh, good.
And everybody is saying wonderful things. You know, there's only so much knowledge in the world. Yeah. And we're all in unison. We all say similar things in different words. And it's so wonderful because sensitive people need to be reaffirmed. You know, we tend to doubt ourselves. And it's so wonderful to hear other people who are in alignment with our thoughts.
Yeah.
Very, very powerful. And I'm so appreciative that you're doing this, that you put this together.
Thank you.
People have no idea how much work it takes to do something like this. So I give you a lot of credit.
Thank you. It's a heart project for sure. So looking at you as the Renaissance man that you are and seeing all of these things that you have excelled at, like it's truly amazing that you have reached the heights that you have in every single area that we just talked about. So how do you identify yourself? Do you see all the facets? Like how is somebody who has so many different talents identifying themselves? Like what does that look like for you?
It's a great question. And it's actually very confusing to me.
Yeah.
And you know, when people like, I have too many hyphens in my name and people have always told me, you know, it's much easier in life if you choose one thing that you're good at and just focus on that, you can get a lot more done. And I was never able to do that. When I was 12 years old, I decided what I was going to be. And I never changed, which is really
what
weird.
What was it?
I think back of, well, I knew I wanted to be a doctor, but my sensitivity was already overwhelming me at 12 years old. I knew I was too sensitive to be a physician where I have to handle life and death situations. And I was going to an orthodontist and I said, you know what? I really like that. I like making people look good.
Yeah,
and so that's what I'm going to be. And I was already writing comedy at that young age. I was writing comedy for the amusement of my friends. And it used to trouble me. I'd say, well, I want to be a dentist and I want to be in show business, but how can you do both? It seemed impossible. And somehow I was able to combine those things because it's always been about putting positive energy out to the universe. That's always been my goal. So
yeah.
When I was a dentist, my specialty was cosmetic dentistry, and I made people look beautiful, and I loved that. I used to lecture on it, and when I taught at NYU, I was in the oral medicine and orofacial pain department, And I was able to use my healing techniques that I call STAR therapy, which is an acronym for Spiritual Transformational Affirmative Resonance Therapy, which I'll explain.
I love that.
It allowed me to treat the physical aspects of stress. For instance, like migraine headaches. In this country alone, there's more than 150 million people that suffer with what they think are migraine headaches that really come from clenching and grinding their teeth from stress. It's called bruxism. And it very often goes undiagnosed. And so in 1999, I approached the Association of Spirituality and Psychotherapy with my work, because they're all classically trained psychotherapists and I'm not.
Right.
But I realized that when you're treating people who are depressed or have any kind of emotional illness, most of the time they're living in the past. They're mm-hmm. thinking what they could have done, what they should have done, and they're fearing the future and they're losing the now, and they're experiencing many physical symptoms like headaches, neck pain, facial pain, back pain, shoulder pain, ringing in the ears.
And it's so all many from symptoms,
all from TMJ, from temporomandibular joint dysfunction. So that was my specialty when I taught at NYU, and they saw me in the clinic taking away pain with my hands. No injections, no drugs, just energy, because I'm a very strong believer in that. I was given that gift as a child.
Did you know you had that gift as a child?
Yeah, when I was 7 or 8 years old.
What happened?
I used to do it on myself and my sister. I remember very clearly practicing my touch on myself. And it's what opened me up to the concept of past lives, because my parents didn't teach me that. My family didn't know anything about it. But if my sister had pain, I would put my hands on her and take it away as a child, as an 8 year old. And so I used it all my life. And when I was in practice, I had a lot of people that came to me with headaches and I would take them away with my hands. I studied many different modalities of healing and I put together this STAR therapy. And the S is for spirituality, spiritual, transformational. And I always talk about the difference between spirituality and religion.
Okay. Tell us what the difference is from your standpoint.
Religion can be wonderful for people, but it puts you into a category, mm-hmm. which automatically excludes people who are not in your religion. They're out of that category. Spirituality brings us all together, because all it asks is that you believe in a force greater than yourself.
Yeah.
Which you can call nature, the universe, God, whatever is comfortable for you. Sometimes the word God turns certain people away when we could be helping them.
Right.
So all we say is this, as long as you know that it isn't you that's controlling your life, because when you think it's you, you tend to blame yourself when things don't go the way you think they should, you know? And that's one of the spiritual principles. You're supposed to try and get what you think you're supposed to have in life. But if you don't get it, you're not supposed to think, oh, I'm the ultimate victim of the universe. Nothing works out for me. Things work out for other people, but when I want them, it doesn't work out for me. You're supposed to think, well, you know what? I'm supposed to have something better than what I wanted. And if I got what I wanted, I wouldn't be available for the really good thing that's coming to me.
So a no means yes in another form, a better form.
Well, in a sense, yeah, I've had to incorporate that thinking into my life. And it's not easy, believe me. I tend to doubt, like you mentioned, things that I've done. There are days when I feel like I haven't accomplished anything.
Yeah.
We all have these negative thoughts, like people have said who spoke before. And very often there are thoughts that were given to us by people who didn't have our best interests at heart.
Do you have a daily practice that helps you stay stable and aligned? I know when you are a very sensitive individual and you pick up on the energy of people around you, as you do, there a lot of times you can get swayed easily. So is there something that keeps you on a very level, stable platform?
Yes, I try. I've been studying spirituality for about 24 years now. And I had to learn to own my sensitivity as a strength. I'm an empath.
Right.
What I didn't know until more recent years, there was a time if I was with you and you were sad, I was sadder for you than you were.
Right.
Because I overfelt my
feelings. Take it on.
Which allowed me to be very effective as a doctor.
Right.
There were patients who said to me, I think you'd rather hurt yourself than hurt me. especially in the dental field, because so many people have fears mm-hmm. of going to the dentist. And yes. usually those fears started when they were children, not something that happened as an adult. A lot of dentists worked on children that had no business working on children. And I used to work on little children, and I would give them injections and they wouldn't even feel it.
Yeah.
I would show them it's a water gun, and I would squirt it for them, and we would be laughing. And so I used my sensitivity as a strength, but very often in life it overwhelmed me because I feel things so deeply, which is what led to my book, Healing Your Heart by Changing Your Mind, because we're all carrying, like, and from the time we're children, every time someone hurts your feelings or breaks a promise to you, or breaks up with you in a relationship or hurts you in any way, we carry that inside of us in our heart chakra, and I call them heart wounds.
Mm-hmm.
So when I talk about healing your heart, it's not heart disease, even though I did have a heart attack a few years ago. And I wound up on stage 5 days later. I was performing, right?
What?
And that I had a widowmaker heart attack. They said I was 95% blocked in the major artery to my heart. And I'm back on stage in 5 days. And the owner of the club said to me, "What are you, crazy? You just had a heart attack." And I was like, "Yeah, but it's really hard to get a spot here. I don't want to lose a spot."
I'll be here no matter what.
It's about mind control and thought control. So we have these heart wounds and we have to release them because of cellular memory, which is a very important concept and something that I talk about a lot. It simply means that everything that you've ever experienced since you're born is still inside of you, every sense.
How do you release it? Like, what do you do?
It's a real process. It's not an easy thing. A lot of it is through thought. But I just wanted to state, like, cellular memory is like, you can hear a song you like, and automatically you'll remember the girl or boy you liked in the third grade when you hear that song, or you'll smell somebody's perfume and say, "Oh, my kindergarten teacher wore that perfume."
Yeah.
It takes you back in time. It's like a sensory deja vu.
Yep.
Every traumatic event that we've had in our lives is still lodged inside of us. And unfortunately, it's lodged deeper than the happy times. We tend to remember the traumatic times more than the happy times. And so it's a real process to release yourself, to undo that thinking, and to examine your thoughts objectively is very difficult. I'll give you an example in my own life. I stuttered very badly from the time I was 7 through my 20s and even beyond into my 30s. Through dental school, I stuttered so badly that I couldn't say my name. I could never say Gurian. And I was holding, I realized one day that I didn't stutter when I was alone. I could go into a room by myself and speak perfectly. I only stutter when I was trying to talk to somebody. I consider it grace that I was given the knowledge to understand that you can't have a disability based on your location. If a man has a limp, he limps in every room of his house. He can't go into a room alone and walk perfectly.
That is, okay, Kuwait, that is like truth right there. That's truth. And that applies to everything.
Yes, it's not only about stuttering, it's about obstacles. Overcoming obstacles. So as an avocation, I work with stutterers all over the world and I teach them how not to stutter. And that's one of the examples I use. And a light bulb goes off. You can't have a disability based on your location.
Yep.
If you can speak well sometimes, theoretically, you could speak well all the time.
So it's just fear? Is that the basis of it?
Well, that's one of the things.
Yeah.
As you can see, I no longer stutter. And it took me years. It was very hard. And I worked on myself to examine the thoughts that I was holding. And I was holding negative thoughts about myself, which many of us do.
Yes.
If you were ever bullied as a child, or people said mean things to you, on some level, you believe those mean things that people said. We don't want to believe them, but we hold on to them. We were like, "Is that really true about me?"
Yeah.
You know? And if you grow up that way, I grew up in a very loving and supportive family, but I grew up with a million fears.
Yeah.
And so I started stuttering, as I said, when I was 7 years old. And I couldn't allow myself to continue stuttering for my whole life. It wasn't acceptable to me. And once I realized that I didn't stutter when I was alone, I was determined. I was literally obsessed. I have that quality, that OCD quality.
Uh-huh.
If you turn it around and use it for something good, it can work out. So
yeah.
I was obsessed with curing myself. And I created affirmations, which I used in that healing technique. The A in star therapy is for affirmations.
Right.
if you create positive affirmation. Someone earlier said that he didn't really believe in positive thinking. And I don't know how it works from a physical point of view, but I brainwash myself. I use affirmations because I do believe that you can think positively. I was in the hospital recently with COVID, double pneumonia. And yeah. if I had allowed myself to go into a negative space, I was sicker than I've ever been in my life.
And so what was it that you, like, when you faced, were you, number one, were you scared?
Yeah, I was scared, but I had to, you know, my new book is Fight the Fear. I had to fight to stay positive. Of course, I was scared. I didn't know what was going to happen.
What was that process, though, Jeffrey? Like, when you fight the fear, I know we're going to give away your book, but what's the process of actually fighting the fear? Because there is that concept in transformation of what you resist persists. So if you're fighting the fear, aren't you making it stronger? So it's a different kind of fighting the fear. So can you describe it to me a little bit?
I'll try to tell you what went through my mind as I was laying in that hospital bed.
Okay.
First, I put off calling an ambulance for 2 weeks. I kept hoping I was going to get better. And I was just too sick and I couldn't wait anymore. This is in New York City at the height of the epidemic.
Right. Right.
At the epicenter. We were the epicenter. This was back in March.
Right.
When the hospitals were being overrun and I was afraid to go to the emergency room.
Right.
And every time I'm facing fear, I have to try to take control of my mind and tell myself that it's going to be okay. When the ambulance crew showed up for me, one of the men took my hand. They were wearing hazmat suits and masks and it was crazy. I felt like I was in a science fiction movie. One of the men took my hand and he said to me, "Don't worry, you're going to be okay." And I have to tell you how much that little act of kindness meant to me, because my feeling is that when we're that sick, we kind of revert to childhood.
Yeah.
We want somebody to take care of us.
Yes. And
unless you're married or living with a family, you basically went through this alone. Most people are going through this pandemic alone.
Yeah.
It's very trying. We're not meant to be alone. It's nice to have people around you. So they brought me to the hospital and they put me in the emergency room next to a woman who was screaming, literally screaming with every breath. And I had to work on my mind. Instead of feeling sorry for myself and say, why me? I had to remember the thought, why not me? It's a spiritual thought. Whoever promised me that my life is supposed to be perfect. And for whatever reason, this is part of my path. As uncomfortable as it is, you can't only believe in spiritual principles when it's convenient, when your life is going great.
Yeah.
It's when it feels like nothing is going right that those principles are important. So I had to remind myself that this is like a weird movie. This is part of my path. And I had to think how much pain this woman must be in and how uncomfortable she must be to be screaming with every breath and not feel sorry for myself that I have to be laying next to her. And so I had to do that the whole time I was hospitalized. They put me in isolation. And then after 2 days, they moved me to a room with three other very sick men. They all had the virus and they were all laying next to me. And I don't know if they were kidding, but they told me the man next to me was from Wuhan.
Oh my gosh. As if I wasn't
nervous enough to begin with.
Are you scared? Well, let's just make you a little more scared.
Yeah, it was crazy.
But that sent the strength of mind to manage your thoughts during that time of fear had to have come from practice. It had to have come from doing it over and over and over again.
It came from 24 years of reminding myself.
Do you have a practice every day that you go through that?
Yes.
What do you do every, what's your practice?
It's not a strict meditation practice. I ask for guidance from the universe, from God. When I wake up in the morning, I ask for guidance to help me to do God's will, whatever that will is for me, to give me the strength to go through it. And are you familiar with the Serenity Prayer? I would hope that people know that. It's very helpful. When I feel like the whole world is closing in on me and nothing is going right, I ask for serenity. The Serenity Prayer is so powerful. Grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference, which is the most important line. Because if I wasn't given the grace to know the wisdom, to know the difference, I'd still be stuttering today.
Yeah.
I'm not powerless over stuttering.
You said something very interesting though there. You said, you know, we're going through the fear. we're not kind of going into the fear and sitting in it and staying in it and kind of amplifying it and worrying about it and getting scared of the fear. We're going through the fear because on the other side of that, we're getting something. Like what you were saying, it's like spiritual laws work. You can't kind of pick and choose when they work and when they don't and when they apply and when they don't. Yeah. So if this is for you, which is a spiritual law, everything that happens is for you. Mm-hmm. So you're in the hospital bed, you've been shifted to the room with three other people, you're next to the guy from Wuhan. It's like, that's a pretty scary scenario.
Absolutely.
Okay, this is for me. So what does your thought do in that moment? Are you looking for an opportunity in that arena? Are you looking for a blessing? What is going through your mind?
I used my comedy mind, believe it or not. I
turned okay, you tried on. To find humor
I started,
in what
we're... Yeah, I started recording things. And I, when, you know, only one person was allowed in the room at the time, I would joke with the nurses. I would just say things to them to make them laugh. When they put me on the stretcher to wheel me out, they accidentally covered my face. And I said, could you please uncover my face? I don't want people to think I passed away. And they started to laugh because they weren't accustomed to patients joking around. When I was on the operating table, when I had the heart attack and they were putting a stent in my heart, I said to the surgeon, I said, I feel you in my heart, not in a romantic way, but I feel you in my heart. Because I was feeling some pain, what they were doing, and I was still awake, and I joked around even on the operating table.
Jennifer, you know what's interesting about this? It's your, and I think there's something here, so tell me what you think. I'm just, in those moments, you were other-focused. You weren't self-oriented, you were other-oriented.
Yes,
you were looking outward, you were being unselfed, right?
Which is outside of myself.
Yeah. So that there's something about the spiritual law of loving, right? Of loving others that allows, it's kind of like what Trevor was talking about with money being energy. If we hold on to it, it dies. If we let it flow through us, there's more where it came from and it continues to flow. And the same thing with your experience, if you're joking and making light of and lifting other people up, that force of love is flowing through you and out the other side. And that brings more of it into your experience. Would you say any of that rings true for you?
Absolutely. You know what? I don't know if it's a sign of insanity or not. I see the absurdity of life. I've always been able to step outside of myself and watch my life as if it's a movie and I'm an observer. Yeah. And I say to myself, wow, this is really weird. Like, why is this happening?
Yeah.
In those two times, like I had been very healthy before I had the heart attack. I was never sick a day in my life. It came out of nowhere. And the COVID thing, I don't know where. I was at a million shows before I got sick. Nobody knows where you catch the thing. But all of a sudden, I'm sicker than I ever was. And it's really scary. But you know what I do? I challenge myself on a daily basis. I challenge my uncomfortability. So many things make me uncomfortable. I went to Japan alone last year. It was the scariest thing I could think of to do.
Why?
For some reason, I always wanted to go to Japan. And two times I was supposed to go with someone and they had to cancel. And I said, you know what? I'm going alone.
Now, why was that scary to go alone?
Because I have fears of traveling. I have fears of getting lost. I have very severe ADHD. So I'm always confused.
Yeah.
And I lose things at the last minute. Even today, just signing into this, I was having trouble. And I think it's because you tend to manifest your worst fears.
So when you talk about affirmations, though, and I hear you saying, well, I do this and I do that and I have ADHD. So when you make the I statements, mm-hmm. are you conscious? Because it sounds like you're very good at managing your thinking. You're very disciplined in training your thought. Are you conscious of making claims about yourself that you don't really want to be true?
Yes, I'm very conscious of it. And I'm very aware that there are people who say, never say that. I don't do things like saying, well, with my luck, this will happen.
Right.
I don't like to do that, which is why I make myself do these things. I also made myself go to Europe alone. And the weird things happen to me that don't happen to other people. I got the tip of my jacket caught in the zipper of my luggage in the airport. I couldn't get it out, and I had to run across the airport attached to my suitcase. I looked like Groucho Marx, like a spider. And I mean, absurd things. Theoretically, that can't even happen to a person.
No.
It happens to me all the time. Because I'm nervous that something's going to happen, I make it happen. But I don't let it stop me. It's how I got on stage to perform comedy. It's how I conquered stuttering. It's how I ran a very successful cosmetic dental practice. It's how I've done everything in my life. I've had to confront thoughts telling me that I wasn't enough, that I couldn't do it. And I said, you know what? I'm doing it anyway.
Right. Feel the fear and do it anyway. So that, but it's that.
Someone once said that. Courage is not a lack of fear. Courage is having the fear and doing it anyway. And that always stuck with me.
Yeah. And it sounds like, so how do you cultivate courage? How do you cultivate that willingness to push through that fear and make that choice? Because that's what people feel about just being who they are. They feel afraid to be themselves and they choose the safe route. They choose to not show who they are. They choose to placate others and show up as they expect to be seen, instead of choosing to, this is really scary, but I'm going to push through that and I'm going to express the person that I am. Like, you know, you are such an individual and you stand out as an individual, but that didn't come from just like showing up. You chose to, you know what, I'm going to wear a scarf or I'm going to wear stripes or I'm going to do something that other people wouldn't normally do and I'm going to stand out. So where does that courage come from for you? Because you express a lot of it.
Well, first of all, I hate stereotypes. So I hate when you look at someone and tell what they do. It's too boring.
Yeah.
When you look at somebody, you go, hey, he works on Wall Street. I think you should do what you want in life and look the way you want. So I developed my own style, my own look, and that's part of my brand.
Yes.
The alternative of not being who you're supposed to be is too uncomfortable for me. Because if you give in to the fear, you'll spend your life in bed with the covers over your head. And I can't bear to do that even for a day.
The alternative is too uncomfortable for you. That's huge.
Right. If you don't find your true path, when you do find your true path, when you do find your true path, the universe supports you. As people have said, things start coming to you.
Yep.
I've been asked to speak at so many things lately. I'm doing a series of lectures at Temple University School of Dentistry, where I graduated from, all these years later, at the request of the dean, not about dentistry, about changing mindsets from frustrating to enjoyable and from hate to love. I never in my life thought that that would happen, but.
That's where you are now. That's it. And we're getting so close. We're getting out of time. I just don't have enough time with all of my guests.
No, but
so,
you're a good host and you answer questions.
Yes, before we go, you are offering half price on your new book. Is that right?
Yeah, you know what? Yes, I am. I mean, that's correct. This is what the book looks like. Fight the Fear, Overcoming Obstacles That Stand in Your Way.
I cannot wait. I cannot wait to read it.
It's a number one release, and I'm offering it half price to anybody who is interested in it. But my first book resonates with your first story, Healing Your Heart by Changing Your Mind. Meditating dog, a dog in lotus position. When you tell the dog story, that's so perfect. The dog on the beach. It really inspired me. And I'm also, if you send me your email, I'm giving away a mini version of one of my comedy books. It was called Man Robs Bank with His Chin.
Yes. That's a good one.
If you like Monty Python and you like silly comedy, you'll love this book. And if you send me your email to jeffrey@jeffreygurian.com, G-U-R-I-A-N, jeffrey@jeffreygurian.com, I'll be happy to send you a copy of the book.
And look at the spelling on the screen because it's Jeffrey without the extra E. It's just Jeff Ree.
Right.
Jeffrey@jeffreygurian.com. Okay.
The way it was meant to be.
The way it was meant to be. Of course it was.
Thank you.
Jeffrey, thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate your taking the time on a Saturday. And I'm you are welcome to stay for the rest of this if you can bear, you know, the whole 4.5 hours. I do appreciate everybody in the audience who's staying because we are going to keep going. And I'm not taking a
break.
Great
time. I'm having a great time. So
right.
Thanks so much.
Thanks
for having
so much,
me.
Jeffrey.
Really
we'll talk to you soon.
I hope so. Thank you.
All right.
Bye-bye now.
Oh my goodness. So if you are interested in, I want to just reiterate the sort of offer that I'm giving, because everybody else is sort of offering things. I feel like, you know what, I really want to offer something. And I have several programs. One is called Choose to Be You, which this show is named after. One is called See You to Be You. And those are both kind of programs. One is a 2-session program. One is a 7-session program, which can go on 7 weeks, depending on how many people are involved in it. And one is called Morning Metaphys, which is a daily, every morning for 15 minutes, where I honestly, I just meditate and pray. And then I show up and I just let the spirit move me. And I say whatever is on my heart that morning to whoever is showing up. And it is a monthly thing that people, I have some people in there who've been there for almost a year. So if you're interested in any of these things, please feel free to go to lisataylorcs.com and use the code, because you've shown up here, this is your bonus. Use the code Choose Me, and you will get 40% off whatever you choose on that website. So there's also the potential for a healing session or healing treatment, or you can just go and kind of explore what's on the website. But if you have made the choice to be here, I want to honor that, because knowing that you are who you are and that there's no one else like you on the planet means that you taking the time to do this and to honor trying to be more clear about who you are and then going out and expressing that means the planet's going to be a better place because you are being who you are. And so I just want to say thank you to those of you who have shown up and are here and give you a little reward for that, because I would love to have you join me as well. It has been a joy and a pleasure to be in this seat and to be able to bring you these amazing people. I am so grateful for this panel of guests that we've had on today. And I really thank you for being here. And thank you for choosing to be who you are, because the world has need of you. So much love to you. Thanks for being here.
Thank you so much for joining us. I am Lisa Taylor, and this is Choose to Be You. We are bringing you this series of interviews that we did during a live event when I invited 9 global thought leaders to the table to talk about this subject. So please do watch for the other ones in the series. They are posted here on YouTube and you can watch them all. Be in touch with me at lisataylorcs.com if you would like to know more. And I look forward to your being a member of this community. We are mighty and we are strong and we are changing the world. If you can see who you are, you can be who you are. And the world has need of you being authentically who you are meant to be. So much love to you, and do join us next time. Thanks for being here.